Good evening. Thank you, Paul. The images are just basically for to give you a sense of the kind of it's from the city in which I live, Jakarta, and as a recent resident of Adelaide and one without a car, I'm kind of stuck within the kind of central 1 square mile grid of central Adelaide. So I thought I would, like, given that, show you images of 4 square kilometers of central Jakarta. And somewhere in the images is my house. And there's a little box on Unijam which is taking bets so that you can bet on which one it is, and you might win some money. So cities throughout Southeast Asia, regardless of location, have become fast lane conduits of money being put into building and other infrastructure. Levels of such investment may be inadequate and vastly inappropriate in some cities. They overreach available consumption and markets in others, but generally make cities more proficient in coordinating and sheltering, transporting, powering, marketing, producing, networking, and informing that makes cities valuable. Now, this proficiency don't lessen the prolonged and even growing misery of large segments of the urban population. They do not mitigate the dangers of carbon footprints and resource depletion driven by the dependence on fossil fuels and the exorbitant sunk and recurring costs incurred by sprawl and segregation. They do not make employment and work conditions more secure. They do not obviate the way in which much urban splendor has been at the cost of dispossessing rural residents of their land. One just has to witness the new Silicon Valley of Jakarta in these images, funded largely through the wholesale theft of land across Indonesia. But despite all of this, contemporary urban infrastructure continues to convey a promise of a better and more secure life. Still, this proficiency has been at the expense of disentangling intricate arrangements of residence, economy, place, and materials of all kinds in dense operations where many things took place in close proximity to each other, exerting effects and pressures that could not always be anticipated, planned, or rectified. As a result of such arrangements, available infrastructure in many cities may be overburdened, illicit activities may proliferate, and intensive mixtures of different logics for making and trading things may be difficult to manage or hold accountable. But these mixtures have been critical instruments enabling people of different walks of life to find multiple venues and devices to feel connections with each other and affirm workable solidarities. These entanglements can implode because too much is expected of them in face of the attrition of public responsibility. Governments can actively undermine them when threatened by the particular identities of the people involved. Entanglements are also weakened by long histories of exploitation and marginalization. When this happens, the seemingly chaotic relations of the street and the markets become incubators of crime and insecurity. Certainly, in many parts of the world, residents must navigate the most minimal tasks and circuits with great fear regarding their personal safety. The proficiencies of the city, its enhancements of infrastructure, communication, consumption, transportation, also can choke off a sense of ordinary publicity, a sense of city spaces being available to experiments of all kinds. These experiments were largely centered on how concrete relationships between people could be used as a basis to make things happen, to improve livelihoods and opportunities for all involved. But now the urban world is increasingly a world where individuals are encouraged to live in all-in-one complexes, from where they need never leave except to go to work or to the airport, since shopping malls and entertainment and schools and health and social services are all wrapped up into one neat package. It was once important to show how things in the city worked, but now the city is more opaque, acting almost like a ghost. Lives become super visible. Bank details, health and employment histories, behavioral profiles, credit ratings, web preferences, social media accounts, timelines, cell phone records, risk profiles, but not the operations of the city itself. But still, within these 4 square kilometers of central Jakarta, much of what the city is and can be remains visible. But it survives in ways that require a variety of tricks, sleights of hand, dogged practices of determination, of giving the authorities the slip. It is probably easiest to illustrate the range of tactics sometimes deployed by residents trying to slip through the various obstacles in order to change their conditions by telling a story. About 2 years ago, a basic story with various permutations spread virally on the internet. It's a cute story without great profundity, but I use it here to illustrate the basic maneuver of giving urban authorities the slip. The story goes like this. An old Italian lived alone in New Jersey. He wanted to plant his annual tomato garden, but it was very difficult work as the ground was hard. His only son, Nino, who used to help him, was in prison. The old man wrote a letter to his son and described his predicament. Dear Nino, I am feeling pretty sad because it looks like I won't be able to plant my tomato garden this year. I'm just getting too old to be digging up a garden plot. I know if you were here, my troubles would be over. I know you would be happy to dig the plot for me, like the old days. Love, Papa. A few days later, Papa received a letter from his son. Dear Papa, don't dig up the garden. That's where the dead bodies are all buried. Love, Nino. At 4 a.m. the next morning, FBI agents and local police arrived and dug up the entire area without finding any dead bodies. They apologized to the old man and left. That same day, the old man received another letter from his son. Dear Papa, go ahead and plant the tomatoes now. That's the best I could do under the circumstances. Love you, Nino. The story says several things about urban life. First, you could obviously consider Nino's actions as a kind of deception. He puts in motion actions that are supposed to dig up the truth about a particular event, an event that is not yet resolved. That is, locating the missing bodies in a crime that Nino seemingly has been imprisoned for. While the problem of the missing bodies in the end remains unresolved, Nino is able to ensure that the garden for his father's tomatoes will have been prepared for planting. Additionally, Nino has claimed to know where the bodies, truly missing in the eyes of the authorities, are located. But is this the crime for which Nino has been imprisoned? In other words, without the evidence of the missing bodies, has Nino indeed gone to jail for this crime? While we don't know for sure, what we do know is that there are various deceptions at work. Nino has convinced the authorities that he knows the location of the bodies. And though he may actually know the real location of the missing bodies, his ability to get the authorities to take the action they did, digging up the backyard, did not rely upon whether he really knew that they were dead bodies and that they were missing. What this tells us is that in all the efforts we make to accomplish things, to make something happen, whether it is to affect other people, set in motion a chain of events, or create the life conditions that we want, is that much of this happens indirectly. We have to go around other people's expectations of what they want from us, what they think we are capable of doing, and what they think we want from them. As soon as we put any initiative into motion, we face misunderstandings, resistance, competition, and sometimes threats. In face of these constraints, we can change our minds, try and adapt what we want, or try to change the attitudes and behaviors of those around us. We could compromise, make deals, or tell others that we will do this and that for them if only they will accommodate all or some of what it is we want to do. We can make our cooperation with others contingent upon their willingness to ensure that we get a piece of the action. In these games and deals, we tend to prioritize what is really important. In all of the things that we want to make happen, we often have to decide how to rank things, fix the value of each thing in terms of its relation to others. Of course, this happens all the time. With limited opportunities, we have to decide upon our own needs or those of our loved ones. Who will get to go to school? Who will get to have extra opportunities? And who will get the bulk of our time, our effort, and resources? Cities are full of things that did happen. There are aspirations that reached fruition, lives that created spaces of maneuver, and opportunities to accumulate resources and experience. And when you look at the history of how things that have happened, how neighborhoods got built, households with money, individuals with a lot of knowledge about things, people with authority, they often did not get to be that way, to get where they are now by going at their goals directly. So people often have to set off to do things with objectives, plans, and working procedures in mind, only to find out that they operated in an already crowded field with others trying to put into motion their own plans. Too often, they found that if they put all of their eggs into one basket, if they committed themselves too much to any one idea, one objective, they might not only lose everything, but get so discouraged that they would settle for almost anything, or convince themselves that what others wanted from them is what they, in the end, really wanted for themselves. So to avoid discouragement and capitulation, many urban dwellers did a little bit at a time. In fact, for many, the idea wasn't to come up with a plan or to have an overriding aspiration. Rather, they just tried to do something, anything, and see what happened. See how the waters got stirred. Who was paying attention? Who got excited or upset? Who cared a lot about what they were doing, and who didn't care at all? If one could do a little bit at a time, you could often manage to stay under the radar, not draw too much attention to yourself, not make others jealous or provoke them to go after what you were trying to do because they either had more friends, power, or money to take it away from you. On the other hand, urban dwellers often did anything to let others know that they were willing to take some risks, to put themselves on the line, to change their conditions, and to work with others. So it did not matter what people put forward as their projects, whether the project be to fix up the house, add a few rooms, start a small business, or pool some money with others to buy something on the cheap. What was important was to indicate a readiness to move, to get going. The specifics of what you put forward were not the relevant thing here. While residents did indeed often want to get somewhere specific, often wanted to accomplish something concrete and tangible for themselves and their families, they were often also willing just to let things happen, to allow themselves to end up in circumstances they never expected, and then learn to call those unfamiliar, even strange conditions home, or at least a temporary home. In addition, many realize that the impact of any single initiative could be increased through it becoming an aspect or component in the initiatives of others. This was not by virtue of the initiative being locked down in contractual relationships or mutual obligations. Rather, it was a way of making whatever you were doing something that could be made use of by others. Collaboration among residents then covers a whole lot of different options. Sometimes residents would simply pay attention to what each other was doing in order to do something else. At other times, there might be collective discussions among relatives and friends and neighbors and co-workers about how to put different skills or contacts together in order to support what remained largely individual projects. Sometimes neighbors would simply silently agree not to interfere with each other's efforts. Still, at other times, residents would run smoke screens for each other, pretending that certain conditions, events, or projects were not underway when in fact they were, in order to control how much attention outsiders paid to them and to ward off any harmful intrusions. In all of these practices and strategies, more than one thing is going on at once. Often what looks to be the reality of a situation is really something else. People look like they are cooperating, but in reality they are just acting as if they are doing it in order to win themselves the freedom to do their own thing. Conversely, people may look like they are running all over each other, stabbing each other in the back, pursuing their own strong-willed aspirations, when in reality, they are implicitly learning from and adjusting to each other, affecting each other, without it looking like they are doing so. These so-called deceptions, then, are at the heart of urban life. And as such, we can't take all of that much for granted. Things are not what they seem to be. Many urban neighborhoods look like they are a complete mess, in a state of disrepair. But something else is often going on. For behind the mess may exist complex local economies, full of different trades and activities silently working together, and where their ability to work together requires that there be no one with sufficient authority to say that this particular activity or object has to go, has to be gotten rid of, has to be cleaned up. In ramshackle and messy environments, people often ask, why aren't improvements being made? Why don't residents simply get together and pool their resources to make their communities nicer? Piles of materials, bricks, old refrigerators, pieces of wood, old tin roofs, wrecked cars, sometimes accumulate for years with apparently little use, and that seemingly could be discarded, yet hang on as if exerting some magical power. Now, of course, communities work hard at community improvement. Even when they do not, it is not a matter always of a lack of resources or cooperation. Rather, it is a sense of letting histories run their own course, of retaining memories of all the ways a particular space and deteriorating object or infrastructure has been used. And this can become important because it lets people know that the neighborhood and all that is within it, its people and objects, are available to be used in many different ways by many different combinations of people. These are environments that not only show their excess of past use, but convey to the outside world that their efforts to impose their orders, their ways of doing things, their attempts to straighten things out and get people to behave all proper are not going to work here. Over time, initiatives that are incremental, individual, collaborative, short or long term, have had a substantial impact on the urban built environment. In some areas of Jakarta, for example, every street and lane is characterized by mixtures of the old and the new, the single and multi-story, with all kinds of materials and design styles being put to use. While districts may contain mixtures of residences, single rooms for rent, commercial storage, recreational spaces, churches and mosques, these mixtures take their own particular form and emphases block by block. Now, as indicated earlier in this discussion, residents thus live in a built environment that allows or constrains particular comings and goings, visibilities and vantage points, soundscapes, inputs and evacuations of raw material and waste, and public exposure and private containment. In other words, these are city spaces where there are many different ways to get something done. Many different alternatives to accomplish things when the way that you are familiar with or prefer just isn't possible now. People who live and work in these places know this. How do they know this? Because the way these places look, full of different ins and outs and different kinds of stuff and different places where you can put your body. All of this reminds them of these possibilities every day. The city authorities and other outside powers may come into these places and look for the missing bodies, for all the casualties, the bad influences, the sicknesses, the immoralities, and the damages, but instead may only find 100 varieties of tomatoes. Coming back to the story of Nino and his father, Nino offers his papa a gift. By telling the authorities that the bodies were buried in his father's backyard, he offered the very means of lending a hand that his imprisonment seemed to make impossible. At the beginning, there seemed to be no way that Nino would be able to help his father. The crime, the judges, and the jail got in the way. What Nino could offer was a confession that ended up being a lie. The failure to produce the bodies thus guaranteed that Nino's act was going to make things more difficult for him. Often, when someone confesses to knowing something that others have wanted to find out for a long time, there is an exchange. The prisoner may get some time shaved off from his sentence, or win more favorable treatment, or at least soothe a guilty conscience by having finally confessed. But here, Nino will not get anywhere with his action except the satisfaction to have helped his father. This is a gift that had to overcome obstacles, and it had to be wrapped up in a confession that hid the fact that what was being offered was not the truth, but a gift. Since the gift was predicated on a lie, it was not going to take Nino anywhere else. It would not free him from prison, nor from any guilty conscience, if indeed he had one. But it says a lot about gifts, and a lot about the kinds of sensibilities that have been at work in building cities in the so-called global south or majority world. Of course, with long histories of colonial rule, cities like Sao Paolo, Karachi, Mexico City, Lagos, Jakarta, and Manila were full of so-called gifts brought by the Dutch, the Spanish, the British, the French, the Portuguese, or the Americans. There were the gifts of education, religious faith, infrastructure, modern institutions, and so forth. And of course, these apparent gifts were not that at all. They were offered at a big price as a display of power to show the natives who was more capable and to justify the theft of land, the theft of people's spirits and resources. These were gifts that could never be fully accepted because they entailed all kinds of future obligations. Obligations that still are impossible to pay back. But there were other kinds of gifts. Gifts more like Nino's. Gifts that entailed individuals risking getting into more trouble than they already were in, so as to help those whose subsequent efforts they may not have been able to witness directly. Nino will probably never see the tomatoes growing in his father's garden, but yet imagine them thick and ripe on the vine. Cities are full of such offerings, residents willing to take the risk to try something different, even if they did not believe that this was going to really represent who they were, even though their actions were not going to tell the truth about themselves. Nino had the perfect excuse not to be able to lend a hand. After all, he was in prison. What could he do? He might have felt guilty, but anyone would have excused him if he were not able to help his father in this instance. Cities have largely been built by people who have gone out of their way to offer things, their experience, money, or time, for projects of uncertain returns. In our work in Jakarta, looking at the history of neighborhoods in the urban center, residents repeatedly tell stories about simple housewives that became activists, businessmen who hired all the hardened criminals, car mechanics who fixed broken water pipes at no cost, and police who turned their posts into schools for kids who could not afford the regular ones. There are hundreds of stories about people saying one thing so as to accomplish another, of appearing to follow the rules in order to bend them, of looking like they were cold-hearted people in order to better care for those who were vulnerable. Now, of course, cities are full of parasites, of the elite trampling every aspiration of those who have little, of people stopping at nothing to get their own way. Cities have often been places of imposition. There are the impositions of particular agendas and ways of doing things. Practices of imposing become generalized. Fire departments demand cash payments at a scene of a burning building before they will put the fire out. Water basins are contaminated by polluting industries. The examples are endless. Imposition is a process of not taking into consideration. And thus, it is a refusal of a relationship, a refusal of the relationship with the city. A gift, then, is an action that makes a relationship with something where otherwise there might not be any basis for doing so. Just like Nino, who did not have any obvious basis to help with his father's tomatoes, a critical dimension of urban life has been the capacity of people to make relationships with things, events, and people that on the surface do not seem to have any obvious connection, that don't seem to belong. In the mixed neighborhoods of Jakarta, while the have and have-nots may not dine with each other every evening, they still manage to make relationships with each other even if there is no obvious basis for doing so. People will go out of their way to offer advice or a hand, even if they are not eligible to do so. In other words, even if they do not have the background or official training to get involved in someone else's life. In fact, the willingness of people to act even when they are not eligible, even when they do not have the authority, education, social, or personal background to, has been the key to the ability of residents to forge relationships with each other, and thus, through those relationships, create opportunities for work, for better livelihoods, for spaces of freedom that would not have been possible without those relationships. For if people only have something to say, only will act when they feel eligible to do so, then few people will take risks. People will remain in their corners, in their narrow worlds, and few new experiences will be created and no tomatoes planted. This does not mean that everything takes place has to be seen as relevant for everyone. It doesn't mean that people have to set about making relationships between everything. For conversely, to see or feel connectedness and relevance to all that takes place within the city would of course be debilitating of the plurality of initiatives required for the city to function. Without certain impositions, there would be nothing for others to respond to, differentiate themselves from, or align with. But what Nino's gift suggests is that efforts to make relationships when they seem impossible can go a long way in getting things done. And in order to make those relationships happen, you often have to resort to a kind of ruse. You have to pretend to know the answers that others want. You have to know where the bodies are buried, even if you have no idea, in order to set in motion the actions that will make the relationship happen. For even Nino knew that he couldn't do it alone. He would have to get others involved in any way that he could. The story of Nino and his father also raises a point about a different kind of gift than the one that we may be accustomed to. When I give my children something for their birthday, for example, I select an object or experience directly for them, something for their possession. But there are gifts that happen seemingly by accident and which do not appear to the larger world as a gift. Although Nino concocted his story about the missing bodies in order to get the police to take the action that being behind bars prevented him from doing, neither he nor his father could then announce to the world that, oh yes, Nino had given his father the wonderful gift of digging up the backyard in order to prepare a tomato garden. Such an announcement might create more problems for both Nino and his father than the problem of getting the backyard ready for tomatoes. So this is a gift that cannot look like a gift. This is a gift that the father cannot now claim as his property. If he is now able to plant the tomatoes and then give them to his friends and family, he cannot tell everyone that this is thanks to the gift that he received from his son, a gift that now belongs to him. Thus, the tomatoes are officially the result of an accidental occurrence, something that should not otherwise have happened. So many gifts, so many opportunities to do things in cities, to have a place, to have certain experiences, cannot really be claimed as the property of the recipient. After all, in order for an object, such as a piece of land or a house, to become a piece of property, it has to be recognized as such by others or registered with some authority in order to become something which the recipient can do with in any way they want. In big global meetings on urban issues during the past several decades, one hears over and over that cities belong to their inhabitants. Now, of course, this is a worthy phrase, a phrase intended to promote greater inclusiveness for citizens in urban planning and governance. It is meant to remind us that the city doesn't work and is not sustainable if its resources, spaces, and opportunities are dominated by the few. It reminds us that there are no urban futures without the participation of a city's inhabitants. But if the city belongs to its inhabitants, to whom then does it really belong? And what does it mean for a city to belong to anyone? How long should someone be in the city before they are considered inhabitants? And how do we know who actually lives in a city? Does an inhabitant have to have a formal dwelling? Do they have to work? Do they have to sleep inside the city boundaries? Do they have to be of a certain age? How do we count what really counts? Now, while governing cities requires a lot of knowledge about the numbers and features of the population to be governed, while it needs some sense of order, of who can legitimately do what where, of who has the authority to occupy specific spaces and jobs, cities have also worked by avoiding such counts. In other words, the ability of citizens to learn from each other, to work together, to pool their knowledge and experiences, to bring together different skills and points of view in order to produce new ways of doing things, has often been the result of accidental gifts. This is where people come together and discover each other. They discover each other not because they had to, not because they were fulfilling their civic responsibilities as citizens. They may have been dealing with a broken water pipe, strolling leisurely in the streets at night, celebrating a religious festivity that brought together different crowds, gathering around a traveling food cart in a neighborhood, or having a heated yet friendly discussion on a public bus. The places and opportunities here are not the property of anyone in particular. They do not belong to anyone specific. No claims are being made about ownership. Like Nino's gift, they came about not because someone went out directly and announced to all the world that they were going to dig up a back garden in order to plant tomatoes. They had to work their way through something else. And so cities have to have plenty of space and opportunities for these accidents to happen, for people to run into each other, watch each other, and enjoy each other. Throughout urban history, there have been a lot of fantasies about digging. Australians, of course, depend on these fantasies for their very lives. But here I am talking about digging deeper sub-basements and higher flyovers, digging up the vast old neighborhoods in order to constantly replace them with the latest version on the market. But the way that cities get made is by a different kind of digging. People digging around for new opportunities, pretending that they are not really digging after all. For in the end, who knows where the real truth of the city is buried? We think we can dig up the answers by continuing to look and to look. Meanwhile, many people in the city are just digging, making some use of whatever they find. The results often are not pretty and sometimes cause a lot of problems. But this is how work is created, and cities need new jobs. The critical task is how to reanimate the learning processes that cities once offered, learning about relations, learning how to put them together in conditions that otherwise do not seem conducive, to slip through all of the blockages, all of the constraints. With cities everywhere in the world facing a 30-year window to remake their infrastructure before human extinction becomes seemingly inevitable, a lot of slipping through will have to be learned. Thank you very much.